Do a countdown.
Okay. We are going live in 5, 4.
You have to be quiet on the one, though.
All right, we're live.
Wait, we're live?
This is live.
Ladies and gentlemen, you're live at the Showcase Show with Jack Glazier.
Yes.
Hello, hello. Welcome, everybody, for coming. Thank you. For coming out. It's been a while since the last one we did one of these. I think it was June 2018 was the last one. That was long ago that, like, the last time we did it, that was, like, I think, what, a year and a half into, like, Trump's presidency? Woo! It's felt just an eternity since then. Like, the way that, like, back then, even back then, it would just be, you still have the articles, like, every week, how, like, yeah, Trump scarfs down an entire Big Mac meal at a military funeral. Is this the end of his administration? This is it. And we're all here. And now we know that he's the new FDR. He's never going away. He's staying around and until he dies. So that's what we're dealing with. This is the present day. But yeah, no, it's great to be back doing the show again. This is the Footlight Bar in Ridgewood, not associated with these Ukrainians from the 50s, which is some science fiction that Jacob Graham turned us on to. We're going to have to figure out what that is, maybe give it a watch later. Maybe we'll just watch that movie, just for this show. I mean, you know, have a little, you know, who doesn't love to pirate a movie online? This is also going live to Facebook, I've been told. So now, for posterity, everyone will be able to see this and know what this whole show is. And so we have a really good crop of guests coming up tonight. What we're going to do, as I try to figure out the mic placement of this, is that we're going to start with one of the classic talk show bits that has ever been done, the top 10 list. This is the top 10 things that I've been doing since the last show. Number 10, difficulty in finding a venue that wouldn't research my social media and discover years worth of racist content I posted, which in my defense, those were jokes. And I learned from Reddit that being a comedian is all about being extremely edgy. Therefore, it is impossible for me to be offensive, and you are the intolerant ones for trying to call me out. So, thank you for coming to the show again. Hey, thanks, also. Number 9, I got way into the hobby of flying camera-mounted drones into people's open apartment windows and just kind of checking out what's going on there. You know, just you pop in, look at their living room situation, knock over a glass of water, and then just you're out. Fly that thing away. Highly recommend I look into that. Number 8, I walked into a Central Park public restroom and witnessed a raccoon giving birth to an army of babies. So, understandably, I didn't leave my apartment for 4 months. That it really set you back. Number 7, I enrolled in grad school for English literature because everyone else in their late 20s in Bedside was doing it. So I just thought, all right, this is the natural thing to do. And for $85,000, all I learned was that I really enjoy pretending to pay attention to audiobooks in the subway while I scroll through Twitter the entire time. So, thanks to that. Number 6, I needed that sweet extra time to craft the ultimate Trump takedown. Do you guys want to hear it? This is it. This is going to be it. President Oompa Loompa, sir, it looks like you are the one who's a redneck. What was his catchphrase again? Fired. He's the one who's fired this time. Shit, all right, back to the drawing board on that one. Page turn. We don't have the technology of cue cards for this show, so we're going old-fashioned right here. Number 5, I actually wrote the story for a murder mystery party with my friend group that evolved into a detailed fan fiction of me poisoning everyone who doesn't like my Facebook quotes posts. So just really, let's all take a minute to change our behavior on that. Number 4, courting a wealthy dowager. I just like to say that. It's just fun words to say. Number 3, silenced by every major media news outlet out there for trying to spread the important truth that I heard a rumor one time about how Anderson Cooper likes to get pooped on by other people. I will not be intimidated. The number two thing I've been up to since the last show, I just straight up wasn't feeling it. Wasn't for me. And number one thing that I've been doing since the last show, finally coming to the realization that yes, the world does need another late night show hosted by a straight white guy. Our time has finally come, baby! This is it. Yeah, so that's that top 10 classic Letterman bit, and I'm sure he would be proud, and I know he is proud. I want to follow that up with a quick documentary that I did. This is actually something very important to me, and this is not the fodder for jokes. I really believe in this, and I shot something with Michael Vanderpool and John Papp about the very serious issue going on of doppelgangers and people who look like you. They steal your identity just by walking around and looking like you, being probably acting a fool, and people now think that's you because they have your exact same visage. So it's an important issue, so I wanted to research this and came together with something that I think is going to be really illuminating for all of you tonight.
People have never liked me. Naturally, I wondered, why? Until one day I discovered a phenomenon unlike any other. Doppelgangers. What sounds like a bunch of made-up German nonsense actually translates to look-alike. Or in other words, some random jagoff with your exact face bumbling their way through life and making everybody think their stupidity is your own. Now you may be thinking, Jack, this is just coincidence or your own paranoia. But what do you call it when the same disturbing occurrence keeps happening to you throughout your entire life? I call it documentary worthy. Join me, won't you? You don't have much of a choice.
The math is simple. Most people are idiots. Apparently, most men look like me. Therefore, millions of people know a complete doofus with my face.
Is she? What happens when you meet a good influence and they just start to change you for the better?
That's when your art teacher says you're incomplete.
Yeah, tell me about it. I know, because I had a good influence.
Can the combination of rugged Irish-American good looks and a somewhat odd cranium shape really be the only two ingredients that make up this extremely common face? We went to an inside source for some perspective.
Oh, you mean Jack? I mean, what else is there to say? I mean, I live with the guy. He sucks. Plain and simple.
Harsh words, but could he be confusing me with someone else as well? For official confirmation, I sought out professional medical advice from this doctor to get the definitive answer. What are the odds that my widespread case of mistaken identity is just a delusional fantasy to justify my own poor behavior?
Pretty much zero.
Thank you! With all that squared away, I was back on the path of truth.
I walk all the way straight.
So what do we learn here today? Not much. That a bunch of idiots who look like me can give me the reputation of an asshole, even when it's not deserved. So next time you feel like giving someone a nasty look or a rude comment because you think that they're terrible, it just might not be them. Good night.
Oh.
That's don't worry about that. I'm fine now. After 11 intensive sessions of electroshock therapy, I am now completely fine. I just can't go near any electrical outlet for the next 2 years. So we made a lot of progress there. So our first guest actually tonight, I'd like to welcome up here. He is a local filmmaker, and he's going to show something for us tonight. So please welcome up Peter Sloanlewis. Hope I'm pronouncing that right. Walk on music, I love it. Hey. Thank you. Love that. Hey, good man. Thanks for coming out. Well, good. Good to see you too. Just want to set up what we're going to be showing here.
Sure. This is something that myself and my wife were in Los Angeles last week, and we just shot this real quick to have fun out there. It was nice weather, and I'm also currently working on another show, but this was the most recent thing we did, and it's called Brain Prostitutes. So that's about all I have to say about that.
Psst. Hey, mister. You looking for a good idea?
Nah, I'm okay.
Really? You seem like you like a good idea. You want a free sample?
Nah, I gotta go. Thanks, bye.
Next time you want to save some money, just buy frozen vegetables at Trader Joe's. Blend them. Delicious and nutritious. You want to see what I do for $50?
I guess so. Alright, okay, here we go. I still live with my mom, and she told me to get out of the house and get a job, and I really don't know what to do. I'm kind of stuck.
I can tell you now, you're wasting your time on Craigslist and other message boards. Just go out on the street and meet people. Friends are the way to go. Make connections, and then you'll get a job. And your parents will appreciate it.
Really? Oh, that sounds pretty good. Maybe I'll try that. Oh, okay, thanks. Bye.
Bye. Hey, mister, back for more?
Oh, it's that lady. They gave me great advice. You know, that really worked out. I got a job. I moved out of my mom's house. I got tons of money and all this free time. I don't know what to do with myself anymore.
If you want another good idea, you get to pay double.
Well, how much is it? 100?
100.
What's your big idea?
You ready?
Shoot.
Netflix for babies.
Netflix for babies?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. I don't know. It doesn't seem like much, but I'll try it. Okay, thanks. What?
Trust me.
Looking good there, Tots. Wow, it's that lady with the good ideas. You know, I made like $5 billion, you know? You know, who would have thought that Netflix for babies would be so popular?
Ooh, of course you did.
And it's kind of crazy because now I got all this free time. I'm like, even more than before, more free time, and I don't know, I'm starting to feel kind of lonely.
Well, you want to know my advice?
All right.
A good idea is always going to cost you.
All right, okay, how much?
$200, double or nothing.
Okay, here you go. So what's your big idea?
Well, first of all, you have to be willing to be vulnerable to fall in love.
Okay.
And secondly, I could just give you a blowjob if you like.
Oh yeah? How much would that cost?
$10,000.
No way, that's crazy. You're nuts. See you later.
Come back up for just a sec. It's basically the format of this whole thing for the uninitiated. It's like a late night talk show where someone performs a screen, something comes up to talk. Is the other mic that's working, is that do we know if that's it right there?
Yeah.
Okay. If you mind just grabbing, we got our handy stage hand here right now. It's just gonna be my undoing. Oh god. Okay, all right, here we go. No, hey, thank you so much for showing that, man. That was really great.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for having us.
And yeah, of course. And I know that, yeah, your wife Julianna is here as well. She was in it. Who was this written and directed by you? By the both of you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Pretty short and sweet. But
No, it was great. And did you, you filmed it in California, you said?
Yeah, we went out to Las Vegas, which was a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah.
I saw the Cirque du Soleil, which is pretty amazing. And then drove through the desert, down to L.A., saw some friends, and yeah, had a good time. And then we shot that as well.
Great. Where was that, by the way?
That was right in L.A. in, Rigo, what's the park?
Echo Park.
Oh, yeah. I believe I visited that the last time I was there. It's a really nice, like, little area. Did you know that you were going to film that when you were out there, or is it a spur of the moment thing?
Kind of spur of the moment.
Yeah, yeah. Right. So you travel with like a camera and stuff like you,
yeah.
Basic stuff to
yeah.
film stuff with.
Yeah, it's a Sony camera. I mean, that sounds kind of nerdy to talk about that, but they're so small that you can get great footage traveling and all that. And
that's one of the big benefits of having those cameras.
Oh yeah,
easy to take around, easy to shoot. Yeah.
Yeah, definitely.
Just making the most of what you can. So like, do you guys often like make stuff like on a whim like that? Do you?
Yeah, we've done a couple of things actually. We went out to the desert and shot footage of a guy getting lost out in the desert in a ghost town. Couple stuff,
Yeah.
I don't know.
That's great. Does that live somewhere online?
Yeah. I have a website that has that kind of things on it.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Sloan Parker.
Sloan Parker,
comedian. But actually, I wanted to talk about. We went to visit the Grand Canyon,
mm-hmm.
and I got this book. It's like, well, I, this is awkward, but I got this book, and it's like about. Well, this is terrible. I shouldn't even talk about this.
Oh please, that's the best preamble to whatever's gonna come next.
It just was on my mind, but it's like all the people that died at the Grand Canyon. I got this book, and it's like crazy, but I can't stop reading it. Anyway, I just figured I'd share that.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's a place everyone wants to go to, but obviously if you're not equipped to get around there, because don't you need, like, a mule to get down? Do you need to ride an actual...
Yeah, I don't know how many people out here have been to the Grand Canyon, but it's pretty amazing.
Woo!
And,
I need to go.
Yeah, but
I know
people,
about that book.
You know about that book?
Yeah,
Yeah, it's like, a lot of people don't really take... I don't know what it is, but they don't take it so seriously.
No. If it was Everest, everyone would be like, oh, Comart, like, it's so deadly and everything like that. But you think that it's like, oh, you go there with, like, your family, you know, there's 6-year-olds running around there. So, like, oh, it's, you know.
I think because it goes down instead of up.
Right, that they'd be okay with that, even though it's obviously the more terrifying one that you would ever want to be near something you just fall into for minutes.
Handle it yourself.
Yeah. Is that, something you shot there will be there as well.
I'd like to go back and shoot something there.
Yeah. Oh my god, that would be
yeah.
Great.
Yeah, that's true.
Do you you've had other shorts, I assume you've worked on that also, are there as well?
Yeah, there's one called Dimples Luigi. And I'm working on a show called Couch Sitters.
Couch.
It's about a guy that doesn't like to leave the couch too much. And
I can identify.
Yeah.
That's,
hopefully
yeah.
it's a wide audience.
No, that's great, and I'm so glad to see the both of you still doing that, because I know that you guys were, I believe at the last show we did, or it could have been the one before that even, it's been a long time since
we've had
these.
Well, we had a great time last time.
Yeah, oh, and again, thank you guys so much for coming up again, this was great to reconnect with this, and hopefully these will be a monthly thing. That's also what we're trying to really get going with these, so... if you guys would like to come back at all, we'd love to have you anytime. Open
love
policy.
Yeah. Definitely.
Perfect. Thank you so much, man. I appreciate it. Hey. Thanks. All right. Okay. So, up next, you know, this kind of professional situation where constantly adjusting the mic and looking at the phone for what to do next. So we have this next guest is actually a person who's been on every show we've done. He is officially our lucky charm. It would be weird at this point to do it without him. So, Pete, I hope you do know that you are lifetime contract to do this. This is completely something you've just fallen into, and you can't get out of it. And you're going to come up here and perform again. So, Peter Brown, perform some music for us. We're very lucky. Welcome to mom.
This is a guitar, so I'm gonna play some songs. This actually didn't have a title, so maybe none of them have titles. But here's a song, untitled song number one. Here we go. Thank you.
But I find that it's similar to them.
One real quick one that I'm going to do.
Please.
Okay. So, this song has a name. It's called Blood. So this is a little bit more fun than that. So, thanks for listening to that. Thank you for having this. Thank you for filming this.
Woo!
This song is hopefully less of a dead. I'm pretty sure, actually, most of the content is like about being... It's always about dying or being dead. Even and for some reason, I think that sounds. It somehow is more upbeat. But anyway, this song's called Blood. You talk all the time, and you learn all the time, and you speak. You don't have the time to hear what I said about the dirt in my mind. I said, I wonder if it'll stay there long after we'll die. She whined, what about me was important? That was hindsight, and we're all gonna
grab that mic right there if you wouldn't mind.
Affirmative.
It's great.
Thank you.
Great as always, having you here perform, man. That's, are those newer?
Yeah, so.
Things that you read?
I think my goal, like this, it's like a cycle, so it actually works for my creative process. I hope I'm loud enough. It works for me because I'm incredibly slow and infrequent with writing songs. So you doing this, well, not, it's been 2 years, actually? Year and a half?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that works perfectly. So, yeah, I've written like 3 or 4, actually more like 5 or 6 new songs. But like I try to only use new material here.
Okay, yeah.
That's going for anyway.
Right. You can just probably take the thing off there because it's annoying to have it right there.
Yeah.
But you, you've done every show we've done so far. I think you played new stuff at every single one too. Do you keep up with it? Is that a thing that is just kind of comes to you when it does?
I mean, it's the normal songwriting process, I feel like. As not a totally 100% or like professional musician, you know, you write when you can, and
right.
sometimes it doesn't come easy. But yeah, it's just mostly I write about disaster, so there hasn't been one for a while. So it's much harder when there are no disasters.
Yes, but hopefully good in the long run, just for your own.
Yeah,
being.
It's a trade off.
Yeah, it's a
But it's been good, and you know, I'd say relatively pleased with some things that I've done. That but the disaster stuff is much better.
So. Right, that a lot of you know, like any artist would ever say, like you know, it comes from a place of you know, pain or you know, just strife, and that's when you get the really good like
all the good punk came from the time, like, you know, the Raven era or whatever. Yeah, when things were really shitty.
Yeah.
So the first one was Untitled, the second one was Blood, you said, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I'm really bad with song names.
How do you keep track of that? Like, how do you...
I don't, it's really difficult.
Yeah.
I have, you know, like, three or four people who know my songs. They don't know any of the names of the songs they have. I say, what song? And like, if they say, oh, you should play this one, or... hey, that song's great. I'm like, what? I don't know. So I just really need to work on it. For the longest time, it used to be the first word of the each song was the name of the song. But
easy enough.
Easy enough, not really, because as not a totally advanced writer, I would say, I found out that almost, say, like 75% of all my songs start with the word I. I got I1, I2, I3, most of them.
Yeah.
So that's kind of a problem. Did the what's the first? Neither of those songs started with I. So that's a good sign.
Yeah. Well, I don't think Blood. Did that start with Blood?
No.
No. So that's weird. Actually. Yeah.
Yeah. Shit.
You're evolving.
I'm on my way.
That's a song. You're on your way. And well, we'll have you any step of the way.
I appreciate it.
Yeah.
And thank you for doing this, and it's always fun.
Oh, dude.
And,
thank you for coming.
Yeah. If anyone else you know that plays music wants to play instead of me, for instance, Chris should play.
Yeah. Oh, and I don't want this to be any pressure on you now that it's just like, oh, hey, Pete, I'm doing another one of these. So drop, guess what? You're going to have to stand up in front of people and perform. That's always been a, we're blessed to have that, but absolutely, there's other friends of ours who are great at playing music, who I don't have to make, you can actually sit and enjoy the show if you'd like,
well,
not have to worry about coming up.
Thank you so much, either
way,
and hopefully, I would definitely love to play again, so hopefully.
Perfect, man. I mean, do you have any sort of SoundCloud or any deal like that?
Oh, yeah, I do have a SoundCloud, but it's... weird. And it has only old stuff on it. But yeah, all of my things, it's my name mixed with a friend's name. It's Pete Bruge. I checked it beforehand to see, because I put it all up on YouTube. You have to search Pete Bruge. B-R-O-U-D-G-E. So, if you would like to look it up, you can just ask me and I'll give you the spelling again.
Just message you, yeah. What's the second half of that name? Who's the...
It's my my friend, whose last name is Boudreaux. So,
oh, so the... yeah.
Yeah, he's a Booge.
Right, it's a Booge.
Yeah.
Classic Booge.
So I just smashed those together at one point.
Smashed them and it worked great.
Yeah.
I'm going to look that up later, add that to my queue. I hope you all do out there. And we say it every time and we mean it every time. Thank you for coming out, man.
Thank
As
you.
As always, appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Hey, thanks.
Have a good one.
No problem. You can do that right there. That table. All right. Oh, okay. A little bit of set decoration going on. All right. For our next guest, Jacob Graham. He is a very, very talented artist and performer, puppeteer. I recently saw a show he did at Dixon Place. Yes, or I kind of want to call it House of Yes, which is a different place because he was involved. His performance was Creatures of Yes at Dixon Place.
There's more dicks in House of Yes.
That's a good color commentary there. I think we're going to curb that back. We're going to have to talk after that. Jacob Graham, I'm so excited to see this. I myself have not seen this yet, but I can only assume that you will have a very, very good time. This piece in particular, which you had to text me so I would not butcher this, is Lucifer Brings Electric Light to the 1893 Chicago World's Fair. And we are especially honored to have this here because puppetry also a long history with the Showcase Show. I don't think we've ever had, it's been a while since we've had live puppetry as well, so anytime you can actually have an excuse for that, I'm for. So, yes, I believe it is time. Darker up here?
Yeah, is there a way to unplug these lights?
Let's see.
Thank you. To the fine city of Chicago. I would like to just bestow upon you the key to the city. I'm John Roach, I'm the mayor of Chicago. It's just a figure of speech. We don't actually give anyone a physical key.
Why don't you like that? Why do I want an actual key? And then I want it to be on the copy.
Well, there isn't one.
Wow, that was incredible.
Thank you
for doing that. Bringing that here. Have you done this before?
I've done this once before in Atlanta, Georgia, at the what's it called? The Center for Puppetry Arts had a puppet variety show. I did it there.
Was this recent? Like, where you were in there? You're in Georgia recently.
It was. The fall of 2018.
Wow. Okay. Well, thank you for making this the New York debut of that piece. Yeah.
I've been wanting to do it again because I worked pretty hard on it, so I was like, I want to, whip it out.
It shows, man. I mean, how much rehearsal goes into something like this when it involves so much multimedia. Of music, effects, voice, projection, like color.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, when I work on a piece, it's very furiously. So it's hard to recount what happened. But I just, I begin. It helps when somebody prompts me. I got invited to perform in this show down there. So... it's like if someone gives me a prompt, I'll go crazy.
Right. I am so glad that I gave you the prompt to do that again. Because that is not like anything we've done before here. And actually a big reason why I wanted to do this show again for a very long time, but like it was just hard to find the drive, things were going on, it was just busy and hard to do it. But last month I saw a show of yours, The Creatures of Yes, at Dixon Place.
Yeah.
And that was such a just fun, like magnetic live experience where you're realizing this is all just happening in front of you and completely live and coordinated, like to a T for something that didn't have a lot of time. It sounds like to actually perfectly rehearse.
Yeah. Well, I always have this idea of like making a show. You know, when I was a little kid, it's like, oh, we're all here, why don't we make a show? You know, what else can we do? And I think I've seen a few performers over the years in like little places do something really interesting. And I thought, it makes me think, this is what people in the Midwest think goes on in New York. You know what I mean? Like, this is like from like a movie about like, you know, where some like normal ass person finds themselves at like a thing in New York and like something just really weird happens, you know? So I always think like, I like that, you know? That's why I moved to New York. Right, because I saw those movies where, you know, like there was that weird scene in like She's All That where he goes to her like club where she hangs out and they're all like in these weird, it's like a spandex, like amorphous thing, and it like gives birth and they do like, I don't know, slam poetry or something. You know what I mean? It's just really weird.
Yeah.
And that's what I'm into.
Yeah.
You know?
But like I was saying before, like when I saw that, when I saw Creatures of Yes, it was a huge impetus for me to do this again because I realized how fun it is to put on a show.
Yeah.
I think that you do all the time as a kid and you get older and you go like, no, well, no, my life now is serious thing, finance. And finding a good parking space. And then you just can't do that anymore.
Yeah,
and
I don't care about any of these
things. Why would you? Yeah, no.
I hate parking spaces. I hate finance.
Two of the least fun things I think ever could be do. And you're also such a trooper again for doing this in this period appropriate costume. Because this is a very cold room in here. And again, thank you for for bearing with us during this. This is...
Well, that's okay. I mean, it makes me feel sexy, so...
That's all the inner warmth you could ever need. That's just... That's... Yeah. I was going to ask you for this. I'm not sure if this is the exact same year, but it was... You said it was the
1893.
Was that the one in Chicago?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, so do you know about the... I believe it's The Devil in the White City. Have you heard about...
Is that a book?
Yeah.
I haven't read it, but I've heard about it, yeah.
It's really interesting. I say anyone read up about it. It's very interesting. Grim. But during the World's Fair there, there was this gentleman.
All the murders.
Yeah. He had like a murder house where he was like this guy who had like a nice house and he was like somewhat of like a gentleman. Mm-hmm. And would bring people back to his house and he just had like a straight up 1890s Saw like murder house.
Yeah.
It killed like dozens of people. It was just like there's no story like that before.
I hate that.
Yeah, it's not pleasant. I do bring it up because it's like the one thing that, like, unfortunately, is like a thing I remember from those World's Fairs that also don't happen anymore.
I'm really obsessed with that idea. The idea of like a World's Fair. I mean, if someone tried to do it now, it would be very suspect. It'd be like, we don't care that your corporation. No. You know what I mean?
Oh yeah, no, there's like, nothing.
Yeah. Like. People probably felt that way back then, too.
Yeah.
But it's, like, easy to romanticize, you know, and, like, the birth of electricity and all this stuff when people, like, had never seen it before, and it was like, this is magic.
Oh, yeah, seeing, like television for the first time, I think, was even shown off at one of those, the World Fairs.
You know what? I always read this story about, like, the beginning of, like, film, and they're, like, there are all these people in, like, a room like this, you know, and they showed this film of, like, a train coming at them, and everyone was like, ah!
Oh, yeah, everyone ran away.
A train was going to come at them, and it was like, what, were they stupid or something? Like, that's so dumb. Like, you wouldn't think, you know. Like, you know right away. Yeah.
Even
if you've never seen it before.
Never seen it before.
You know.
It's basically a moving painting, so you know it's not a flat image. That unless you think it's going to become some, like, serious...
I think those people were, like... They were, like, hamming it up.
Yeah, oh, yeah, you know? Right. They had a few. There was nothing to do back then other than drink and to...
Oh, I hadn't thought of that.
Oh, yeah, right. What would you do? Everyone smells. Everyone's racist. Life is awful.
Yeah. Have you heard of, like, the... what's it called? Like, phantasmagorias from that time?
Yeah, a little
like
bit.
Magic
yeah.
shows with, like, magic lantern projections of demons and stuff. But the craziest thing was that they would... What was it? They would put on the floor, like, tiny little needles or something with, like, opium. And they'd make everyone take their shoes off. So people would come in and, like, just be like, ah, you know, and then they'd see these projections of demons in, like, the 1800s in France, and they would just Like, that to me is the ultimate show.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? There's nothing like that anymore. Like, the, that must have been more, like, better than anything.
Oh, yeah, there's no comparison to anything at that time. And the really most frustrating part is that there would be no video of that. And all I want to see is that actually happened back in the 1800s.
It's a dream.
Yeah. Walking through a minefield of opium on the ground. And I had one question for you also, because what I really liked in the last show, Creatures of Yes, was... there's a minor character of, it was Miss Sprite, 1963.
Yeah, do you remember that?
Oh, yeah, it was a great costume and everything. And it was a perfect, and you had made it, it was like of a Sprite logo and design that was perfectly period appropriate.
It was a Sprite beauty queen with a sash that said, she was Miss Sprite, Wisconsin, 1963. She had the sash and the crown and the cape. Yeah, that was my friend Sasha.
And that was great, and given with this, with the
nobody
the
liked that. Nobody liked Miss Sprite. They didn't get it. There's nothing to get.
No, people. Oh, that's a bad crowd. If people need to find some meaning behind that, other than it's just it's grid design. It's really funny. But given with all the images of the projection with the blanket up here and having the image of the statue, also from that's the famous thing people know. But like, is there images from the past you feel really tied to in terms of when you do your performances?
I think I'm really obsessed with the past, like in a dark way. Like I just can't. I don't know. I think everything I do is very informed by this vague, hazy, romantic thing I remember from the past, whatever it is, you know?
Right, yeah.
And to my own detriment.
Yeah.
Because I could never be modern. I could never, you know? Like it's like, oh, I made a little display you saw at my Christmas party this year. It's called Christmas of the Future. But it was like, from the perspective of the past, and everything I used to make the display were like antiques. But it was like the future.
Right.
Because we've lost, like, I don't know. We've lost this idea that things can be very beautiful, you know? And I don't mean that. I mean, we're in a good place with, like, I'm a homosexual.
I think that's how you're allowed to say that.
Can I say that?
I think so. I think they're okay with that now.
Okay,
New York State.
So.
Yeah.
So, I, you know, like, that's good, obviously.
Yeah,
that
yeah,
was, like...
Yeah.
But I also romanticized the past, where it needed to be, like, you know, like, a hidden thing. Like, that seems more interesting to me.
Right. And yeah.
You know? I like it when it's, like, a subversive thing.
Yeah.
I'm not part of the homosexual agenda that wants to assimilate. I want it to be its own thing.
Right, yeah. And I think there's a difference between people who worship the past too much to be like, the good old days, like, why can't we go back to that, like, you know, the 50s, back when people knew how to, like, have manners or whatever. Like, there's, and that, and you, like, having reverence for the iconography and, you know, the different ways that people had to perform or express themselves, given there was no sort of mass media or internet or anything like that. So it felt very kind of unique and special in a way.
For sure.
But hey, thank you so much for coming out here. I love this piece. I hope you can come back again to do one of these if you would ever feel like it.
I'd love to.
Yeah.
I'd love to do some juggling.
That's everyone look out for that juggling next time. It should be in a month. We're making these monthly, so in a month's time we'll see some juggling. Thank you so much, man. Thank you. All right. Next we have I don't know how this got on here, but someone kind of passes along my way, and so we kind of make things fun, and this is a guy. We have Steve Cleveland from the Billings Institute. This here is a quote, master impressionist. I guess we'll go with that. Steve, if you would like to come up here. All right. Got a mic right there. So you got some impressions here. figure let's go with one. You know, it's pretty timely now. We all have Netflix. We've all seen The Irishman. And let's do with a classic Bobby D. Robert De Niro. Let's hear it.
All right.
Let's have it.
Can you give me a little bit of a drum roll?
No.
Okay.
Hey, look at me. I'm The Irishman. Pretty good. Pretty good.
Pretty good.
I'm a raging bull. What do you want from me? Huh?
Those are both. Yeah, hey, that's both. Both those things were hit. Yeah, he did both those. Yeah. And I have one here. Okay, so maybe a little more difficult. Al Pacino as Robert De Niro.
All right. Can I have a little bit of a?
Look at me! I'm the Irishman! Pretty good! I'm a guest star! Heat! We're both in heat!
Okay, yeah, so, yeah, it's kind of more... A little repeating that same, but you're right, they were in heat, so you're right.
Thank you.
You're informing. We got here, okay. I guess it's just going to be more evolved as they go on. Arnold Schwarzenegger... As Al Pacino, as Robert De Niro.
Yes. Do you think you could give me a little bit of a...
Hello? Look at me. I'm the Irishman. Pretty good.
All right, I'm going to need a note. What is the Billings Institute? Did they sponsor this? Who are you? What is... Why?
It's an orthodontic institute.
Okay, and you just kind of delight the staff there with your impressions? They kind of told you were funny? Is that why you came to do this?
They asked me to leave.
Okay, well, they asked you to leave. So you're not from... You were from the Billings Institute in that you're not there anymore. Well,
I came here from the Billings Institute to do this.
Okay, all right, yeah. So I'm good we know that your last location. I'm sorry we didn't specify where everyone else was directly before they came to the show. We'll amend that next time. Can't say that this has been a useful use of time at all. I really don't know why you came up here. I guess this is just a wild card, but this is not an impression I've ever even heard before. Let me just put you on the spot. Because really roast you here, because you really have wasted my time. What's a Robert Duvall? Huh?
Can I have a little bit of a...
No, you can go into it.
Michael! It's me! Robert Duvall from The Godfather! Boo Radley!
He was Boo Radley, you're right. Hey, you know what? That was it. Yeah, give it up for Steve here. Steve Cleveland. We like to, we have an open door policy at this show with a lot of our guests. We like, maybe we should restrict that open door policy, because clearly anyone can walk through that open door. Oh boy, okay, let's move on to an actual guest now, someone who is legitimate performer, and someone who we were lucky to have actually at our first real showcase show ever. She's here to do some comedy, and so please welcome up Julianna Schley.
Do I have to talk beforehand? I feel like...
Oh, no, please.
Okay.
Go right in.
Okay. So I never dress sexy in public because I hear all these stories about catcalling, and I'm just worried if I dress up, it still isn't going to happen to me. Like, why put in all the extra effort just to have some guy yell nice tits at another girl while I'm like, hashtag me too. Just once I want to confront a guy like, hey buddy, I'm not wearing these crotchless panties for your viewing pleasure. They're crotches due to general wear and tear. But actually, you don't really have to worry about me. I'm married. And we have a third person to think about now. That's right, we got a roommate. Yeah. So I'm pretty happy in my relationship. My husband is a recovered alcoholic. Yes. So he's been, so he's been sober for 2 years. Now I just need to get him to start brushing his teeth. So, you know, like all these different platforms are coming out with streaming platforms. Like there was Netflix and now Amazon Prime has one. I'm just kind of waiting for Craigslist to come out with their own streaming platform. I think it'll be $20 a month or best offer. It's going to be cash and carry. And just spoiler alert, you end up getting murdered at the end. So I'm actually going to start my own streaming network, and it's going to go kind of like this. Screaming network. So I recently noticed, we just moved apartments, and I noticed that there's something in my apartment that's aging me really rapidly. So I was like trying to look into like the air quality or like the water, and then I just realized that the lighting in the bathroom is better, so I could see my skin a lot clearer. So I started looking up all these like different fads online, these anti-aging things, and I've tried charcoal masks and manuka honey and brushing my teeth every day. And I just realized the best thing is to stop giving a fuck.
Yeah.
So the best thing about not giving a fuck is that you can really focus on what matters in life. My weight. That's it. So I'm actually really in good shape, but I try to be kind of secret about it. I want to be healthy, but not too healthy, because if I ever die prematurely, I don't want it to be ironic. So there'll be times when I'm at a club and people are like, wow, Julianna, you're a really good dancer, but I'm actually just trying to get my steps in for the day. Kind of like this.
But I keep moving, can't stop, won't stop grooving. It's like I got this music in my buds and it's gonna be all right. Cause the player's gonna play. Nobody's gonna hate. Baby, I'm just gonna shake it off, shake it off. Heartbreaker's gonna break. And the faker's gonna fake. I'm just gonna shake it off. Hey. Just think, while you've been getting down and out about the liars and the dirty, dirty cheats of the world, you're gonna get down to this sick beat. My ex-man brought his new girlfriend. She's like, oh my god, I'm just gonna shake it to the fella over there with the hella good hair. Why don't you come on over, baby? We can shake. Yeah, this is a great party.
Woo!
Woo! All right, that's my time.
Thank you.
And I actually got kind of warm too, so.
Yeah, I know that benefits for a room this cold, yeah, because you really need to actually warm up the joints just for even sitting here for a long time. Wow, that is the most involved piece of stand-up comedy I think I've seen, live at least. That's to leap off the stage and come back. That's more than I think most people would do.
Yeah, people get kind of surprised by that one.
Yeah, it's good, because as soon as anyone, like, when performing just leaves the stage, there was always that moment of, like, what the fuck? Like, no, you're up there for a reason, like, we're down here watching, like, you can't broach that. That was great. Do you perform any, like, regularity, or do you ever find, like, open mics or stuff like that?
I've been going to open mics, and people hate me so much. Oh my god, I never get any laughs. So that was in L.A. and people actually laughed.
Hey, there you go, yeah.
You hear that, New York? L.A. is better than you in some way. New York, get it together. They're catching up with us.
The fact that you can even do an open mic to me is just like, or anyone who does that, it's like unfathomable to me in a way. Like, I do this, but this is always just like mainly my friends, mainly people I know, and like it's such a structure where like, I get to have a notebook and have other people I can call up to do other stuff, so I don't focus on be on me. But do an open mic, probably in front of no one you know, and just yourself and alone individually up there. I don't understand how the body doesn't shut down out of a panic. Like, I can't... Do you still feel that? Did that feeling go away?
No.
No,
so
okay.
I still... I mean, honestly, and also stand-up is just as scary as you think it is. So, like, I know, like, sometimes people say, oh, waiting is the scariest thing. Actually, when you're up there doing it, it's terrifying.
Yeah.
And also, there are many times... I'm still a beginner. I just started in, like, the fall. But there's many times when I choke on stage, too. I get nervous. People don't laugh at my first joke. And I just lose all confidence. So I feel like a lot of doing stand-up is just getting used to not doing well. And I think that's
right.
A really healthy thing in life, too, is just to be really comfortable with failing.
Yeah. Oh, because it's the only, especially if you're doing comedy, especially doing open nights, like, or open mics, if you were to actually, like, kill every single time, that would be, like, it wouldn't make sense. Like, that's not even part of the process. It's literally all about just doing until you learn what works, like failing, because that's the only way to learn exactly what, like, you know, isn't gonna play with certain crowds, because, like, it's just, and the repeatedly doing it over and over again, like, I, like, thinking about it makes me tense up, like, I can't even just, oh, I, thank God I have this, because I could never do that. How long ago did you start doing open mics?
Well, I did my first one in the summer, and then, like, around November, I was like, okay, I should start doing this more. Before, it was kind of like, not a dare, but it was like a personal dare. Like, are you really going to do it? Like, can you do
right.
stand-up?
Yeah.
You do everything else. And I guess I'm always, I have a lot of anxiety, and I'm, like, a very anxious person, and I always want to push myself out of my comfort zone. And, like, the more you push yourself out of your comfort zone expands.
Yeah.
So, like, I want a bigger comfort zone, and then I can do even scarier things.
And that's, I mean, that's, like, the best thing you can do with that, too, because I've thought about, like, you know, trying to do that, put myself out there, but it's the hardest thing to do. You can think that. It's a really easy plan to have, but following up on it is, like, the hardest thing you can do. So, like, actually going out there and doing that is, like, that makes me want to go try to do the same sometime, try to, like, you know, keep doing these things, because, like, yeah, once you, if you just keep staying in that same place, you're never gonna evolve, you're never gonna really learn anything from that. I was thinking, though, because you said that, you know, open mic crowds notoriously not the most receptive to stuff like that.
It's all stand-up comedians.
Yeah, and I'm sure it's mostly a lot of guys, and if I had to think,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, and that fact that if you're doing, like, material about being a woman, that would, like, for the most stand-up guy comedians, I feel like I absolutely have that feeling of just, like, that's not for them. They just sort of, like, not feeling it.
The funniest thing is the worst mic I did was a woman's mic. Like, oh,
yeah.
That one was bad. I was like, oh, I can't believe I just bombed so bad in front of all these women. But, like, yeah. That was probably the worst one. But yeah, it is very, very male. Most of the mics, I think a lot of women start to learn where they want to go and where they don't want to go. And I've noticed if I show up in a room and there's, like, one woman or no women, I'm like, okay, this probably isn't a very friendly mic. And a lot of times it ends up being true. The host has a lot to do with, you think of the host as just being someone up there introducing the next person, but they really create an atmosphere in the room. And if the host doesn't like women, it becomes very, you feel it. And then you have to just go, I don't give a fuck. I'm just going to get
it.
Up here and do my thing, and maybe I'll do well and maybe I won't.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. And just,
I love myself no matter what.
But yeah, that's kind of great to hear. Honestly, do you have anything, I don't know if you ever post any, because I know you do short films you know, with your husband as well. Do you ever post any comedy stuff ever?
I'm still, like, I'm not really ready to
right.
start
oh, yeah.
putting myself as a, I don't know, it's, like, complicated. I'm still making art, I do, like, film stuff and music, and I do all sorts of stuff like that, and I have website, but, like, I feel like my stand-up comedy, I'm still such a beginner. I'm, like, I guess I'm being, like, a little bit precious about it.
No, totally, and I mean, the same way that, like, a lot of comedians feel weird about people ever, like, recording them. Like, especially if they're just doing, like, working out materials, because it's like, oh, no, well, you're doing this to work through something and kind of get it to where it should be. You kind of, like, recording the process of, like, getting there, it's like, well, you're just going to see things that don't work because you're still actually working through it. So, yeah, no, it's totally justified in not wanting to have a permanent record of you learning how to.
But if you want to see my work, like my other work, my website is juliannaschley.com, J-U-L-I-A-N-N-A, Schley, S, C as in cat, H, L, E as in elephant, Y.com. I have to do the, you know, that thing because no one knows how to spell my name. Or my band website is ungrata.com, U-N-G-R-A-T-A.com. And then I might have some stand-up on there. No, I don't think I do.
That's a band?
Yeah, I'm in a band, too.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's great. What do you guys do?
It's an experimental noise music band. There's, like, I play the trumpet.
That's, I'm already on board. This is, needs to happen for another show. I'm already,
booking it.
That's, and how long have you guys been around for?
Since about November. I guess November was November.
Well, I'm glad that we could have this show here for you to come out and keep, you know, doing your material and keep building that up, because I hope that you keep that up, because there's a lot of stuff in there that I want to see done again. And if you want to ever come back to do music, comedy, screen, anything, we're open for you here. Thank you so much again for coming out. That was great.
You.
Yeah. Awesome. Give it up for Julianna. I think we're going to wind down the show. One last guest here. He is the other person responsible for making the show a reality. So if there really is, I'm the talent. So if there is anything you don't like about this, it is squarely on him. So take that all up with him. That's Michael Vanderpool. Coming up here.
Hi, I need to open the curtains.
You would need what? He's gonna open the curtains. Okay.
So hard.
It doesn't look as easy as it should be. Or also, I think you might just be a weak man. There you go. I know. I really like the. We need to get these for our apartment. We live together, by the way. That's a spoiler to everyone out there. So you have a video selection to show?
Yes.
Good enough for me?
It's a work in progress. I have like hours to do, and this very clip you're about to see, which is like 1/8 of it.
Again, he likes to make excuses, so, this thing might not be good because I'm working on it. Yeah, okay, buddy. Like, let's get real. No, he actually has been working on this thing laboriously for months because he's a one-man editing and animation machine, and I've seen bits of this. I can't wait to see the whole thing, I think you're all gonna like what you see. Also, and there's those Ukrainians again.
Thank you.
what do you call this? A critter pillar?
Yeah, this is the critter pillar.
Right.
This, and you've been putting this together for how long at this point?
This has been, well, I'm, how long, Kyle? Since I made the giant leaves in our house, like a year and a half. Audience participation is
don't
the best out. Part of any show. Well, I made a bunch of giant leaves because I thought that it would be cool to put the caterpillar on giant leaves. But then I was just like, wait a minute, real leaves look better than giant fake leaves. So I shot real leaves, and then I had a bunch of giant fake leaves in my apartment for about 6 months. And Kyle hated it because he would run into them, and they'd fall all over the place. Yeah.
Yeah, normal problem that we have in a Brooklyn apartment.
Yeah, yeah,
the homemade leaves you have are too big.
I'm just excited. I wanted to see the garage, the garbage man's face when he saw a, like, six giant leaves in my trash.
I think any given day a garbage man would see things far more horrifying or just generally unexplainable than that in general. But... you have been making this a short that you will have. It's like this one part of the story.
Yeah, this is just the very beginning. I showed some woman at my work. She asked me what I do for life outside of work, and I showed her this video clip. And she looked at me and she's like, "Oh, what's the film about?" And I'm like, "Oh, the caterpillar just loves the fall and wants to stay afterwards. Doesn't want to go south for winter." And she looked at me and goes, "Does the caterpillar die?" I'm like, "Ma'am, yes. The caterpillar die. It freezes to death for all the kids."
Yeah.
The lesson they have to learn at the end of the film is you have to leave New York City. You're gonna die
and
if
that
you stay
yeah.
here.
And that you will die, no matter what.
You're gonna die one day, and you're gonna be alone. All your friends are gonna be south in Florida.
It's such a shame that that fake caterpillar that didn't exist had to die the way that normal caterpillars do naturally in the cycle of the animal kingdom.
Yeah.
So I believe you said you had, I think you quoted it as the greatest story that you'll ever hear in the year 2020. You said that you had something like that queued up. So I thought that sounded pretty notable.
Yeah.
I gotta go feed the meter, so you just take this over.
Oh, no. Well, once upon a time, I wrote this into a movie, but it's not working out that well, so it's gonna be another, like, 20 years for this to actually come onto the silver screen. But it starts out, I'm 7 years old, and I find this dog underneath the dumpster in the middle of Missouri. And naturally, we bring it home because we're rednecks. That's what we do in the South. We find an animal and we just take it home. And it just wreaks all sorts of havoc on our neighborhood. We bring it home, and my sister is the first one to get a bite gash right out of her left leg. And she pretends it doesn't exist because... as a 8-year-old girl, you think, oh, I got really brutally bit by this dog. I'm going to be in trouble when my mom gets home. So she hides in the closet and lies about it for 2 days. And my mom's like, "Honey, what's that bandage you got around your leg?" And she tells that the dog bit her. And my mom was like, "Okay." As a good mom does, she keeps the dog and everything's fine and has no punishment for the animal itself. And then a few days later, we get a ring on the door from this old man who's bringing us flowers because we just moved into the neighborhood. And he's got this warm grin, this Midwestern grin on his face that says, "I love Jesus and I love you because you're my neighbor." And Allie runs between his legs and grabs him right on the thigh and then bolts. And so quick, we don't even see it. He's just kind of has these flowers in his hand, just shaking. And he goes, your dog just bit me, ma'am. And my mom calls him a liar. But like in a funny way, he's like, no, she didn't. But he's definitely been bit. We looked at his leg and there's scrapings of broken fabric. I don't know how that man just tolerated not calling the police or doing any sort. He just didn't want to talk to us ever again. I feel like in the Midwest, you meet someone new, you bring them flowers, and if they do something wrong, you just kind of ignore them for the rest of your life, because they're going to be in your life forever if you move into Missouri. People get off the exit on Route 85 accidentally to go pee, and then they end up staying in Missouri for the rest of their lives. It's a town where I had four neighbors. I know all their zodiac signs, everything that's ever happened to them, and I haven't spoken to them in 20 years, and I've only known them for two. They're crazy. And then my neighbor, Penny. Before I get to Penny, Laura Dupre. She wore fur coats. I think Allie thought she was a bear because she walked in such like this hunched over furry way. She had this coat that draped over her head. She looked like a, you ever read Goosebumps? She was the author of Goosebumps, like that kind of dark old lady that knew how to scare children just from uttering a few phrases to their faces. She walked into our house and Allie stripped off her coat and she was in her brassiere screaming, horrified that my dog had what I think is a heroic thing, because I was terrified of this woman too and she knew it. And Allie was defending me. Anyway, no one in the neighborhood talked to us. Because, A, I was covered in mud most of the time. I would play in the mud pit because we were poor. And my mom would just hose me off every day. And I was the deranged kid covered in mud with the demon dog. And my neighbor, Penny, took it upon herself to give us an ultimatum one day. She knocked on our door. And she looked my mom in the eye and said, your dog is ruining this neighborhood. And either I give it an exorcism or you're out. I believe there's a demon inside your dog because she only bites Christians. Everyone in Missouri is a Christian, so her math was right. So she cornered my dog, Allie, underneath the table and did this weird motion where she was gonna put this between my legs. She was taking Allie's hair and using fake scissors to cut the demon out of her. And Allie was very submissive. I thought it was working. The next day I let her out of the house and she looked like a dog who had lost her soul. But I kid you not, the next day there were three dead rabbits mauled all over Penny's lawn. With Allie just with the biggest grin wagging her tail. Her face was covered in blood. And that's why we left Missouri.
And you've never been back since, right?
Never. No. Don't go. Don't go.
No.
The dog was the best part.
It's funny because we grew up together for the most, because you moved to Massachusetts at some point. We grew up in a town together, a very boring suburban town, where you were just smart, nice little fellow, and then hearing about your youth growing up, playing around in a mud pit, and having your mom hose you off with a hose in the front yard because you've just been mudding it up all day.
We also caught grasshoppers and threw them into spider webs for fun.
Well, you're really facilitating, you know.
Yeah, it's nature. Yeah. It's natural. Yeah.
They gotta eat.
It's gonna happen.
It's gotta at some point. Yeah.
That doesn't happen to the caterpillar.
No. Oh, good. Okay. Thank God. I would not want to see that at all. But hey, thanks for showing off your wares.
You're welcome.
And for me putting you on the spot, which I love to do. I love to make you sweat. There's actually one last thing, which I forgot to tell you about, but, do you guys know who Andy Kaufman is? Andy Kaufman, old, comedian, very cool, did a lot of, a Kaufman head out there, did a lot of great, kind of groundbreaking stuff with comedy, and, there's a really good movie about him called, Man on the Moon, starring Jim Carrey as him, and, they show a part at the end where he plays his big Carnegie Hall show at the end. It's like his kind of big last farewell performance. And at the end, he takes everyone out for milk and cookies from Carnegie Hall. And this is about as far from Carnegie Hall as you can get. It's a very cold room in Queens. But if you do look in the back of the room, I can't take him on a bus anywhere. There's milk and cookies ready for anyone who would like to have them. Thanks for coming out. That's my way of giving back. You guys are great. Everyone here is a fucking legend to me for being here tonight. And thank you for coming out. And I'll see you next time when we do one of these, which should be in a month. And we're going to do that. Hold me to that. Scream at me on the street if I don't do another show again in a month. Please. Thank you so much again. And please help yourself and enjoy. Thanks.